think the last time I saw you was with Helen Hunt.
Gosh,
in some
that?
Room, hotel room, some horrible yes. hotel room in Century City.
Yep. in the movie that yeah that we did with Liev and.
And there was a kid there, wasn't there? There was a kid.
But the, yes, there was.
Who and did he's something
gone,
other stuff.
He's gone on to be very successful.
Yeah.
Why am I forgetting the name of that movie? Tell him.
I think I asked you then whether you were a sex bomb. And that stopped the interview for about 2 minutes as Helen got very upset. I wasn't asking her if she was a sex bomb.
Well, that character was kind of a sex bomb.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, that's been, I mean, your career is now 30 years long.
I know.
Is that
weird.
Shocking to you? Or?
You know, it's funny. We were just discussing this in the car because it is so surreal. I was saying we just had the 30th anniversary of Troop Beverly Hills, which was the movie that actually marked my ability to support myself. So it was a very significant movie for me. And I also got emancipated during that time, so I didn't have to have a chaperone on set. So right around that time. So it was a very kind of like key moment in my career. And the fact that I could have been not like a small child and have a 30th anniversary of anything I've acted in is so crazy. Mm. So yeah, for sure it is. It's really surreal. I think what's really nice for me is the realization when I think about that, though, that I feel like when I looked like an ingenue, I never felt like one inside anyway. So I kind of felt like it was going to be later right. in my life and career that maybe the inside and the outside would come together a little bit more. So I feel actually as excited, if not more, and as passionate, if not more, about what I love to do, about acting, than I did. So like it's only grown over those years. So that's cool.
So was there a point where you did feel that coming together?
Yeah, I think it's probably been in the last 5 or 10 years that I've really felt like I'm looking at the world from the inside out rather than the other way around. You know, I think we all tend to, you know, want to be liked and be curious what people think about us or whatever. It's like sort of school breeds that. But I think also for women more so even, you know, it's just so like, there's so much focus, and certainly as an actress, obviously, but focused on, you know, how you look and how you seem, and are you, you know, just so many things. You know, a strong man is considered a strong man, a strong woman is considered a bitch. I mean, there's a sort of, so there's so many kind of double standards that way that you grow up with as a child. Doesn't mean they're necessarily true, but, and so I think there came an organic moment where I was more interested in, mm-hmm. oh, why am I doing this thing? Whether the, because it's such a private, intimate thing that we do that becomes so public, and that's the part you have no control over, right? So at least now I feel really much more, it's much less of a struggle for me as to what the results are of things, and I think I'm much more interested in the process. And so that has been a big change for me, or a nice progression for me that makes it more enjoyable, you know?
So were you very ambitious as a 20-year-old?
I guess I was, but didn't really know that I was. I mean, I think in that same way that like courage is something you don't ever recognize when it's happening. You see it later and go, oh, that's kind of courageous or whatever. I think that when I took this acting class, this man named Gene Bua in the Valley here, mm-hmm. and I took it when I was, my aunt, Carol Merrill, who was did Let's Make a Deal and a bunch of, you know.
My first great love, I think.
Yes, she's of many, many people's first great love. And she had married my uncle Mark. And she was the one who was really kind of like, I think you should be an actress. And I was such an academic, and I was super good in school. And so it wasn't, so I had taken some acting classes and done some plays and stuff. But she was the one who said, you know, there's this class that a couple of friends of mine have taken, and I think you might really like this teacher. And I went and took this class. And by the end of the first scene I did in that class, I said, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life. Hmm. And because I was such a serious kid, people actually took me seriously in my family. And, you know, after the cautionary, really? Really do you want to be? Like, you know, you could say you want to be anything. You want to be an right. astronaut. You want to be a doctor. But you want to be an actor. And they're like, oh. And I understand, you know, because it's such a dicey profession. But in terms of just being able to be successful at it.
So what do you think you would have been if you weren't an actor?
Now it's hard to say because it's been so much of my life. Yeah. But I'm a big, you know, I love food. I love health, and so I think maybe like I would have gone into being some sort of a holistic doctor or a chef perhaps. I think for a while I entertained a lot of things just more in a protection mode of what if this doesn't work out, what am I going to do? And I think now that I've been doing it for so long, I think I've explored so many different, I've gotten to go watch brain surgeries in person. I've gotten to, you know, I've gotten to go to different cultures and work with different people in terms of accents and upbringing and all those things, so that I've ended up, I think my hunger for doing other things has been fulfilled through acting, and I feel so grateful for that, you know.
Well, you've always had kind of an authority as an actor, I think. Even, I mean, that whole thing is that your looks have been part of it, and at the same time, I can't remember you playing a particularly weak or kind of, you know, bimbo-y or passive character so much.
Yeah, I guess there has been a feeling of maybe some sort of fortitude. I don't know. It's interesting because when I did the point at which I did Entourage and then also Californication, both of those characters, Amanda in Entourage and Abbey Rhodes in Californication. People were like, you know, you're so tough and badass and, you know, hardcore, whatever, you know, all these different sort of words for those characters. And I was thinking, it's so funny because I'm not like that at all. And like, I mean, I can be so much more confident as those characters. And perhaps maybe there is a real fortitude that is there that I'm unaware of, that just came from my upbringing and starting acting very young. And I guess that's back circularly to your point of ambition. I don't know, I guess maybe it could be ambitious, but I think I was really clear. I was really clear on what I wanted to do. So it came from a very practical standpoint, like, oh, I found what I love and I now want to do it. But I guess I was ambitious to think I maybe could, you know, maybe that was something that, that was in place that I see now. In the same way that I was, you know, living on by my own by the time I was 16 and all of those things, which I look at 16-year-olds now and I'm like, God, I felt like such an adult, but I was such a kid, you know.
Well, and that was, Troop Beverly Hills must have been 15 or 16 years old at that
point. I was 16 and I lied and said I was 14 to get the job. And actually, I remember so clearly because I said to the director, I was shooting long enough that I knew he couldn't fire me. And so one day I said, you know, I just so you know, I'm actually 16. And he said, I would have never hired you if I had known you were 16. So then my lying was like affirmed. I should have lied to get the job, I guess. But I don't know what that tells you.
Well, there's stories like that. You talk to actors and how they, you know, got started. And a lot of times there's that's part of the, whatever that first thing is, you know, like Judy Greer had to pretend she was living in L.A.
Yeah.
And slept on somebody's floor.
Totally.
To get her Jawbreaker or whatever it was. Because they wouldn't pay for her to live somewhere or whatever.
And, you know, Naomi Watts' story is amazing. I mean, there's so many people that, you know, it's interesting too, because I think now, at the beginning, I think always I've wanted, there's something that's been very consistent for me, which is that I've always wanted to be a transformative actor. I've never been really interested in branding myself or in kind of being known for one thing. I always wanted people to be able to watch something and kind of fall into that character. And I feel really lucky that for the most part, I've been able to do that. And at first I think it really confused people because it was like, wait, you're the, you know, the mom in Spy Kids, but the lesbian parole officer in Sin City, but the neurosurgeon on Chicago Hope. And, you know, it was this sort of like a, and like there was no type to be able to kind of hold on to. And I think, by the way, it's human nature. We just want to understand who someone is and kind of like go with that in any, you know, just in life.
Yeah.
So I don't fault.
But particularly in Hollywood.
But particularly in Hollywood. And so so I think that it also, though, in a strange way, I think wanting to disappear into characters perhaps isn't as initially dazzling, and also has a combination of being confusing. So sort of had I cared about being famous earlier on, I would have made a lot of different choices and I could have sort of attained that kind of, but I think for me, there's been something that's always been, like I really want to do it until the day that I die. I mean, you know, I hope that many years from now we're talking and, you know, I'm getting pulled off the stage or something because it's the end for me, but long down the road. But I think because of that, I now feel also really grateful for the longevity of my career, even though I still feel like I'm at the beginning in a lot of ways for myself.
So was the work just natural for you? Did you do a ton of work as you got past your teens to become a different kind of actor? Or?
Training and stuff. I mean, I've trained throughout. I never went to university because I did start working. I kind of made a really big decision at that moment because I was valedictorian of my class, and I was sort of like really, as I said, I was an academic. I moved a ton as a kid. So I think when that happens, you either are really good or really bad in school, you know? And for me, it was the one constant. Like, I was able to go to school and study, and I understood that. And so it was a big decision not to go to university for me. But for me, it was the right decision. But within that, I've studied with many teachers over time, and you know, I am a student by nature. So, you know, also working with different people, like Liz Himmelstein for Dialect. I mean, she's extraordinary, and she's been my dialect coach since I was 18. Mm-hmm. And we've worked on so many characters and so many people. And so I feel like I'm always studying within what I'm doing, I guess. I'm not an actor who just kind of shows up to set and sees what happens, for sure. And there are those who are extraordinary, you know. But I think what I like to do is I like to do as much preparation as possible. And sometimes you don't have it. I mean, for example, for something like Gerald's Game, I got cast in that late in the game, and I wasn't sure. I got cast, but I read the script for the first time 2 weeks before I was on camera for that. Mm-hmm. And that was a 6 day a week, 24 day shoot in which I was in every frame, and you know, she's dealing with so much psychological stuff, and there's just, it was a role that I would have loved to have had more time to prep for. Mm-hmm. And I almost didn't say yes because I wasn't sure if I would be able to deliver in the way that I wanted to. But then it scared me so much that I thought I have to do it because it scares me so much. So, you know, but I think that when I have the opportunity to prepare, my ideal is to do all the preparation and then let it go and just, right. You know, sort of.
Do you like being scared part of the choices you make?
I do.
Well, do you feel after 30 years in the business, which I feel strange saying to you, your actual face, but do you feel now like you have enough more choices? Because a lot of actors, even with a lot of success, feel like they're kind of still waiting for the next job and you know, trying to figure it out.
I feel like you always, there's something probably ingrained in you that will always have a little bit of that. I remember when I did this movie, the first thing I worked with Liz on actually was in Latvia, in Riga. And it was Paul Haggis's first movie before Crash was his first movie, and it was called it was called Red Hot. No, he would laugh. But it was called Red Hot, and it was with Balthazar Getty and Armin Mueller-Stahl, and Donald Sutherland played my father. And I remember Donald saying to me one day, he said, "Carla, do you know that feeling when you finish a job and you feel like you're never going to work again?" And I said, "Yes," and I'm waiting for the wisdom from him. And he said, "It never ends." And it was at that point that I sort of was devastated and also freed at the same time, because I thought, well, if Donald Sutherland feels this way, then I don't need to give a lot of creed to it, but I'll know that I'll be feeling that way. But I will say, I am so grateful, and I do not take it for granted for a second, that I feel like at this moment in my career and at my age and at this stage of my career that I have the opportunities that I have. I am so grateful for that. And I think that it doesn't mean that I have huge goals that I still want to attain, and I have many roles I want to play. But the fact that I have some really interesting choices, I feel, you know, is really amazing.
So you have a series you're starting that premieres in a month.
Yeah, yeah.
Where you're the lead of Jet on Cinemax. And you guys, that's been sitting, apparently has been sitting in the can for about a year, which happens a lot at HBO and Cinemax.
Well, actually, no.
No?
In fact, no. We just, not with this one, but it was very long time in the making. The first time we pitched it to HBO Cinemax was 4 years ago. But then it wasn't the right timing. We went and pitched it around. People wanted to do pilots of it. And we were really determined to cross-board it like a movie, Sebastian Gutierrez and myself. And then it came back around with the same group. But no, literally the post finishes on Friday.
Oh, that's interesting.
And we just turned in episode 9, and it just locked on Monday. So no, it's actually...
IMDb needs to be
Yeah, I know.
Corrected.
Well, we need to do some. I also thought about that today because I was at IMDb earlier and I thought there's something called Swinging Lanterns that is on my IMDb that I've never done and we can't get it off.
Well, it's funny because we had Darcy Carden was in a couple weeks ago and we were talking about Barry.
Yeah.
And that show, they piloted it and then it sat for a year and a half.
That does happen a lot, yeah.
And because HBO and Cinemax do this slow roll thing.
Yeah, totally. No, I think Warrior, I believe, was maybe done over a year before also for Cinemax. So, yeah, that does seem to happen. In this case, not as much, but yeah.
So Hill House, which is what we came to chat about today.
Yes.
But, I mean, you have that and you have Jet where you're the active lead probably.
Yeah.
I'm assuming. I haven't seen the whole series, but I assume you're in most of the scenes.
Yeah.
Is it a different journey to go into one project than a different kind of project where you're... In Hill House, you're more of a, you're in every episode,
right.
But you're not a constant
part
of it.
Yeah, you know what I think I would just mark? For sure, there are differences, of course, in terms of screen time and stuff. But I think in both of those circumstances, I learned something that's really important for me at this point in my career, which is I was able to be very much engaged creatively from very early on in the process of both of those projects. So because I had done Gerald's Game with Mike Flanagan and he spoke to me about Hill House then, and then we started as Olivia, the character that I played, was coming to life in the writer's room, we started having conversations really early on before I think maybe one of the scripts was written. So I got to be a really active part of creating that character. And obviously for Jet as well. Now, I would say those are also two instances where both Mike Flanagan and Sebastian Gutierrez are exceptional writers. So it is, and directors, but on the writing level, in both of those cases, I can kind of come in with an idea or an instinct about the character, and they can run with it on the writing level in a way that I never would be able to do. Mm. So for me, that's like the key to collaboration. What I have realized is I kind of want to do less things that I have. I want to do more things that I am more intricately involved in from the beginning, because I feel like I can also deliver on a performance level more so in that way as well. I don't really like to just pop in and do something and leave, I realize. I really like to be part of the storytelling process. And what's been nice is I've found collaborators to do that with.
And how does that change how you're directed? Is that a different experience?
Well, I think it does in the sense that maybe we're all clearer on the story that we're trying to tell, and I feel more engaged in that. But I do love direction. I mean, I'm not an actor that comes in with a set performance and that I want to just give. I've done a lot of homework and I've delved as deeply as I can. And then I really, if it's people that I trust, I mean, I'll just jump off the cliff and I want them to tell me if I've gone too far or if something needs to be pulled back or if they want me to go further. And it was interesting to go. I was supposed to have 6 weeks in between The Haunting of Hill House, which I had been on for 8 months, and Jet, which I was then going to be on every day pretty much for 5 months. And it ended up being 1 week in between. Mm. And it was really, and I was also, I'm obviously a producer on Jet, so that was also just I was helping to cast it and all sorts of things. So it was an interesting thing because Olivia is so deeply emotional and what's happening to her is such an emotional experience. And so that was just a vastly different character from Jet. So the first week on Jet of shooting, Sebastian, who obviously we know each other very well and we've worked together a lot too, was... you know, I've always wanted, and it's sort of that thing of be careful what you wish for, but in a good way, I've always wanted to have that kind of director who can really mold you when needed, because that's when you don't have to have that eye on your own performance. I can direct my own performance, but it's not mm-hmm. that fun. And I feel like it's really difficult to be exceptional when you're directing yourself. I think you can be really good and in few occasions can be exceptional, but mostly you kind of end up watching yourself in a way that I think is better not to as an actor.
Mm-hmm.
So in that first week, I mean, Sebastian was diligent about, he was like, too much, I'm seeing too much empathy. Less. And he kept pulling me back to the point where I felt that everything that I feel validated about being an actor or have been externally validated for was not what he wanted in this role.
Mm.
And about a week in, I clicked in and I was like, ah, now I know where she lives. But she's much more, Jet is much more like a Toshiro Mifune or you know, Lee Marvin in Point Blank or young Clint Eastwood. Like she is, she keeps her own counsel. She's really good at what she does. She's not introspective. You know, she's not Robin Hood. Mm-hmm. She's super non-reactive. So she's much more like what, you know, for Jet, I watched a lot more male performances. Mm. And I was never interested in taking on male characteristics as much as so often as a woman, you're asked to come into a piece for very good reason to bring a heart or a depth or a complexity. And the man gets to be a bit more stoic and a bit more mysterious, you know? Mm-hmm. And in this case, that was Jet's job. And, you know, in fact, I would say like sort of the femme fatale of the piece is played by a man. And, you know, it's just a very different landscape, which was really fun to explore.
Which Sebastian, I think, has explored a little bit before in those other movies.
Yeah, no, for sure. And he's, I mean, you know, and he loves Elmer Leonard. He loves the Parker novels. Like, you know, he has, you know, and he has certainly, you know, Barry Gifford is somebody he's a fan of and also a very good friend. And so he has that kind of, he's so good with that kind of dialogue and, mm-hmm. and those kind of, you know, criminals who, you know, who eat their Cheerios for breakfast too, kind of thing.
So is Olivia, going back to yeah. Haunted Hill, do you find a place with her and then you're there? Is every episode, I mean, it's always fascinating because people talk about, you were saying before, that they were writer's room.
Yeah.
I thought that Mike had the credit on every episode. Maybe I'm wrong about that.
Well, writing, no, there was a writer's room on that one. Sebastian had no writer's room and wrote every single script of that. But Mike has, I mean, you know, Mike is the director, the writer, and the editor.
Right.
So Mike is, I mean, it is his.
But there's like
no
this thing now
what.
Where these shows are doing 8 episodes. Like,
yeah.
There is, I can't see a season 2 unless it's another family completely.
Right. Well, yeah, there is going to be a season 2, but it's an anthology.
Right.
So it will be an entirely different story.
Yeah.
No, for sure. And that was so.
But
yes.
It's interesting that there are now these different shows where it plays like an episodic.
Yeah.
But it's really a long movie.
Totally.
In a weird way.
Yeah, no, I know exactly what you mean. I think, and it is, and I mean, and we didn't fully crossboard Haunting, whereas we did Jet, but no, Mike is, you know, had his hand in every script, but there was a wonderful writer's room on that. But that was interesting for me because the key to that was, at the beginning, you know, he had sort of talked about, before I saw it in script form, the idea that in trying to save her children, she ends up almost killing them, right? And I thought, God, that is such a good idea, but so hard to pull off. So hard to imagine any mother doing that, and what's our way in? And I started, we started these conversations, and I all of a sudden had this sort of instinct to visit Oliver Sacks and to revisit Oliver Sacks, who I think is such an extraordinary writer in dealing with the brain. And so I picked up Hallucinations again, and I started reading about oral migraines and sort of how you both see things in grids. So I was fascinated by that because she's an architect. And so I thought, oh, this is maybe what has allowed her. So many artists have them. And, you know, Lewis Carroll famously had them. And there's talk about maybe was Alice in Wonderland done from that perspective. And so I started like thinking along those lines and sort of threw it out to Mike just to see if he was even interested in going down that road. And he was really interested in it. And again, then made kind of really extraordinary choices that I wouldn't have necessarily been able to make as a writer based on that. But it became a huge part of our character because I also was really interested in why the kids wouldn't notice the behavior early on, or her husband, why he wouldn't start to see what was happening. But if she had episodes throughout her life, then that would be a reason why it's like, oh, Mom or Olivia is having these episodes. So they're going to kind of like not notice it as much.
Right.
And it would also potentially make her more susceptible to the house. Like, I was wondering, why is it her versus anybody else? And so then we started kind of exploring the fact that perhaps that whole side of women in the family had had a history of kind of being white witches on some level, or, you know, sort of psychic in some way. So
when you went to shoot episode 1, did you know what episode 9 was going to be?
I had not seen the script. It wasn't there yet. He talked to me about where it was going to go. We also had to be really careful because she had to remain a mystery for so long, because the episode in which you finally understand what's going on is 9. So
right.
It's a long. So she had to be compelling enough. You had to be engaged enough with her to care. And yet, we couldn't really give anything away. So it was a really interesting challenge.
And you're jumping around time, and you're even jumping within your story.
For sure. And I was definitely like a horse at the gates. Like, I've never been so ready to shoot something as I was nine. I mean, I really was like, you know, because it felt like, because every time I left set and came back and left Atlanta where we were shooting and came back, I felt like I had to put the boiling kettle on the back burner, mm-hmm. but I couldn't turn it off. So I was like living with this woman for months. Hey. And it was not a comfortable place to be in. That role cost me in a lot of ways that were interesting, but worth it because I really love her so much.
You know? So did you have any interaction with the adult versions of your children until before the end?
Very briefly. Well, I mean, we were on set a lot together because, for example, when we did episode 6, which are all those long takes, mm-hmm. One of them obviously connected.
Right.
So that we were there. But also I went and watched a lot of their takes of those. And, you know, Tim Hutton's character, obviously I come back as a ghost. So that was interesting, too, because, you know, it was also what Olivia is that. And that is really not the real Olivia. That's really his memory of Olivia, mm-hmm. which is different than the real Olivia and also different than the Olivia who has become part of the house. So those were all subtle things that I didn't want to ever do anything that was like acting acrobatics and be like, look how different she is. But I wanted them to be subtle enough that upon revisiting the show, you do see the differences. So that in episode 9, when, is it 9? No, episode 10, when I say, you know, when Olivia says to the older Hugh, he says, but you were with me. And I say, well, that wasn't actually me, that was you. And that was sort of his putting her in kind of a little bit of a pedestal in his memory that was different than who she was.
Well, I think that's the show in a lot of ways. I mean, for me, it was I watched it in a big clump. Because you were coming.
Thank you.
I hadn't watched the show yet, but it was fascinating to me because I thought that it was, firstly, not a horror show, really, which was interesting.
Yeah.
And then it really had a universality. It's very specific.
Totally.
But then there was a universality to it that is fascinating.
Sure. Well, and it is about grief, and it is about family trauma. And it is about how we compartmentalize and where we put that trauma, and eventually that we will have to deal with it. And I think that the thing that Mike did that was so interesting to me is that he comes back around to healing and to coming full circle. And that's a very unusual choice in this genre. You know, he was not interested in jump scares, though there are a couple, there are very few. Mm-hmm. And it was really about these kids that, you know, were subjected to the disappearance and death of their mother in a very traumatic way that they were never told the full story about. And it's not until Nell's death that they come together and start revisiting that. And that these, you know, like I do think that as we can all probably attest to, our minds are the scariest place. And that's what the house is symbolic of, really, you know.
And pain in families is often suppressed and
for sure.
not discussed. So people have their own memories.
And their own versions, exactly. Yeah. And our versions that we have of our memories are absolutely true for us, even if they're, I mean, how many times have you talked to your parent and said, well, when that thing happened, and then, you know, your parent will be like, that never happened. And you're like, it did because it affected me profoundly. And, you know, but from their perspective, they weren't, you know, it's just right. vastly different. It's an amazing thing. And I think that that's interesting because as, you know, I'm appreciative of you saying that about the genre, because for me, I would never gravitate to watch a horror show per se. I will always mm-hmm. watch something that I think is good in whatever genre. But I think that when people actually see the show, they see that it's a much different show than they might have thought it was.
Well, you could strip away, though. In some ways, I kept on thinking you could strip away the horror elements and it would be a good 10-part drama.
Well, you know, it's so funny that you say that. So wild that you say that, as a matter of fact, because you're very instinctual on that note, because last night we were doing the Netflix panel and they just showed episode 6. But Mike Flanagan got up and talked and he said, you know, the way that I look at horror is I have to strip every horror element from something and see if it still works as a drama. And if it does, then I can start exploring those horror elements. And that was very important to him with Haunting of Hill House. So it's exactly what you said.
Well, if you have a family member that has a drug problem, for instance,
yeah.
you know, there's always that process of trying to figure out why.
For sure.
And the questions of what the trauma was.
Yeah.
Which may not have been experienced by the other kids, and you know, yeah. It's like it just doesn't. It's always floating.
And then you have like Elizabeth Reeser's character that, you know, has made it where she's looked death in the face and she's able to deal with it very practically. And that's her way of avoiding the feelings that are around it, you know?
As best she can.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was wondering, it was very strange, it's surreal, because I watched it because of you. And then I was like, for the first few episodes, I was like, oh, it's the Elizabeth Reeser show.
Yeah. No.
And then everybody gets their episode.
Everybody, yeah, I know, it's interesting. No, and it's by the end, then the people that you got to know really well at the beginning figure less in the end. And, by, you know, it's a very interestingly structured show that way.
So your episode, because you do have an episode where you were the dominant character and we tell your story mostly.
Yeah.
Was that, when you do it, do you look at dailies? Do you look at the playback? Are you just trusting yourself with Mike completely and going for it?
Well, I think that one we shot so fast, and it was the one that was most like an insular movie. Like you could just kind of pull that episode and have it mm-hmm. be just in the way that he structured it. So that one we really just, we were able to shoot it not fully in sequence, but as much in sequence as we could. And I think because I do have such a shorthand with Mike and also with Michael Femignari, our director of photography, who's brilliant, we just hit the ground running. And Henry is so wonderful. And, you know, Annabeth Gish is, like, I loved what she did with that character. And so, I don't know, I think we were able to just go deep. I mean, I do watch the monitor sometimes, but mostly it's for a technical reason or to see if something I'm trying is coming across, and once I know that I feel that it is, then I'm not interested in watching anymore. So, mm-hmm.
Do you feel that when you're in the groove in a situation like that, do you know that it's happening?
Yeah, I think you do. I think you do for sure. It was, and also by that time, because I had been, I mean, I really was like, let me at it, you know? I mean, I was just, it had been, it was 6 months into our filming schedule that we did that, so, yeah.
And then after, what is your relationship? You said earlier that you're less result-oriented than you were earlier as an actor, but do you pay attention to reviews? Are you nervous when it's finally gonna be really, a Netflix in that case, the whole thing is?
I know. There's always a really strange feeling about like sending your baby out into the world, for sure, again, because it is so personal and intimate and, it's funny. I read occasionally reviews for film and television, not all the time. For theater, I never ever do. And I remember, and it's because I'm still in the process and I don't want it to affect the creative process. Even if it's super positive, they might point out something that was a very natural thing that then becomes something that I'm aware of from the outside in, and I'm not interested in that. And I remember Alan Rickman, who was a dear friend, said to me, he said, Carla, never read reviews. The good ones are never as good as you want them to be, and the bad ones you'll never forget. And I was like, that is the best advice. So,
he and I had an argument once at a party.
Yeah.
About whether he was a sex symbol. Actually, I'm going to go back to you being a sex bomb, but.
That's really
Alan
funny.
Alan Rickman and I were having, because all these girls, women I knew at that time were like.
Yeah.
They were like, I just want to get next to Alan Rickman. I want to get next to Alan Rickman. And he was like having none of it.
He doesn't consider himself that way, right? That's really funny. Yes, there's always a moment of a slight nerve-wracking feeling, and it's always wonderful to get a sense when something has gone a more positive direction and people really responding, and certainly Haunting of Hill House affected people so deeply. It became such a part of the zeitgeist so quickly. I mean, I did the Today Show with Mikhail Huseman like 10 days after it had come out. And there were so many people who were like, I just watched it last night. I'm sorry, I'm so late to the game. And I was like, guys, it's been out for 10 days. Like, you're not late to the game.
It is weird now.
But
that,
as it is so strange.
Everything's like got to be immediate or you're done.
But as Jet is coming out, you know, what I would say is just that I think, it's not that I don't care. Of course, we make things for people to share it. And I want people to really enjoy it and dig it and get excited about it and all those things. But I think it's more that since that part is out of my control, what I am interested in is making the piece as strong as it can be and knowing why I did it. So yeah, if people don't respond to something like this, it's kind of our fault because we made the show that we want to make, you know? But if people do respond also, it's more gratifying for me to have a hand in making the show that I want to make, because as an artist, that's all I have, you know, is sort of the vision that I'm interested in. And then you find like-minded people, you know? I think that some people are meant to be adored by the masses and that and be responded to by a massive number of people. You see this in music as well. Somebody will just, an album will come out and it will hit in a way that is just, you know, profound and massive. And then you'll find those people who have been people that the, have had a cult following forever, a massive, rabid, you know, obsessive cult following, but it's a smaller number of people. You know, you look at somebody like Pedro Almodovar, who's an exquisite filmmaker who has a huge following, but not, you know, you wouldn't talk to the, you know.
Not as much here.
Yeah, exactly.
We're in the wrong country.
But he's so specific and so amazing. Yeah. He's one of my favorite filmmakers. And you'd never want Pedro to be less Pedro to become appealing to more people. You know what I mean? And so, and it's always been the case with artists. So
I don't think he'd know how to do it.
No, and that's we wouldn't want, no, exactly, he wouldn't, but that's because he's been so true to his artistic voice. So for me, I've had a very unusual career that way because I've done things that have been hugely commercially successful and then things that have been much more smaller and more and very interesting to me, but maybe fewer people have seen it. So I can't ever figure any of that out. So that's why I just have to kind of keep doing what I love.
And do you feel like a cult obsession of... I mean, you definitely you were definitely a known quantity.
Yeah,
you're not a, people are aware of you when you're in things.
And yet it's interesting because I still feel that I don't know if I am what people refer to as perhaps a household name or something like that because...
Well, they can't pronounce your name.
Again,
right?
That's maybe why.
Like
that
Huseman.
Could be it. That could be, exactly. that could be the key. But yes, I think ultimately all of the choices that I've made have now added up to a body of work. I don't know. I've never been able to be very objective about those things for myself, I guess.
One thing watching the show was, boy, you make beautiful children. That is a handsome group of five kids out there.
Yeah, totally.
Very impressive.
I thought the casting was pretty incredible in terms of also us all looking like we could be family.
Yeah.
You know.
No, there were definitely hues in each person of the other parents.
Yeah.
And was it weird being? I mean, did you feel like the mother of this brood?
Well, I know it was interesting because all of my kids grown up are my peers, right?
Right.
So we're all the same, like in the same age group. But there was no doubt that. You know, it's funny. I mean, I played the mom in Spy Kids when I was 27, and I was supposed to have had kids and been a spy for 10 years before that. So it was physically impossible, right?
But at least they were little kids.
So exactly. But there must be something to me that has that sort of quality. And I guess I do love people. So in a way, there's an innate need to take care of people, I guess. And maybe that's where the motherly quality comes in.
And whatever is next after your next, does it, are you thinking about it yet, or are you? Is it in your process over these years? Is it just going to show up at some point in a year from now? Or
you know,
six
sometimes
from now,
I think about things, and something like Jet that's been brewing for a long time. I'm going to go do a movie called Gunpowder Milkshake with a director from Israel named Navot, who is amazing, and with an incredible group of people. It's Karen Gillan and Lena Headey and Angela Bassett, and Michelle Yeoh, and myself. And, Paul Giamatti.
That's a scary group.
I know, and it's definitely a badass group of ladies. And Paul Giamatti just round it out. But I'm off to do that very soon, and then there's something else that I'm going to do after that. By the way, those things were not on my radar a couple of months ago. So
right.
Some of them I work hard and plan ahead, and you have to kind of wait for the right moment to do it. And others, you know, come into your ethers, and you're like, oh, that seems like it would be fun.
And are you doing what you wanted when you were 15 and 16 and escaping
into
this world?
Yeah, I think I am. I think it's just more, I've had to learn more how to enjoy my life because, you know, I think that's the harder part is I've gotten better at kind of like the downtime. My dad is 90 and a total workhorse and just went through a health scare and, you know, is sort of realizing he finally... is going to have to retire, and he's really like having a crisis of consciousness about it. And I thought, I was like, oh, Dad, this is where I got the workaholic part from. And I said, you know, most people 20 years your junior are having to deal with this moment that you're dealing with. I think you should feel really lucky that you're retiring at 90. You know, but there's no doubt that I think that I know my purpose as an artist, and it's always been to give empathy, and you know. To allow myself to see the world through different eyes, and therefore to allow an audience to see the world through different eyes. So that's been, from the beginning, the reason that I've been compelled to act. So that's clear. But what is my purpose in life? That's a much harder question to answer.
For everyone.
You know?
Well, that's what you, but that's what you're exploring.
Exactly,
in a way.
For sure.
You're finding different people to explore it in, but you're still exploring the same
exactly.
thing.
Exactly, totally.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so
appreciate
much.
Appreciate it.
Such a joy.
Thank you.
Yeah. And I love that you have Watchmen over there.